So I want you to imagine just for a moment that we live in a world covered with darkness, yearning for light. We've been looking at where we receive the power and where it comes from. And we learned over the last month in January through salvation, through nothing that we've done, and our power comes from Christ and all that He has accomplished. Comes with the power of the Holy Spirit in our lives. Of course, we don't have to imagine for long, do we, that we live in a world of darkness. The world is in darkness. There's many things we only have to watch the news for 5 minutes to see that not only are other countries in turmoil, but our own countries. Our government is just full of lies and untruths, of no positive leadership, the cover-ups that are rampant around the country. When all that is needed is the light to shine, the light of God in men and women's lives, like it did for us when once we were in darkness and found ourselves wandering along a wide path, aimlessly trying to figure out what was the best way to do things. Today we continue on that path, we continue on a journey, and we look again at the source in our lives, but not just where it comes from, what we are to do with it. And that's a very important statement for us. What do we do with the light and the power that we've received? We sang there, "Shine, Jesus, shine." And we looked at all the verses there. We see that there is a sense of that if the Lord Jesus comes into our lives, then surely His light shall shine through us and impact other people's lives, touch their lives. Indeed, as we saw Catherine explain to us, it's no coincidence that she's here this morning. This was chosen by the Lord Jesus. I just set out what was ahead of us in the next few months, and as you've seen, it's been put on a notice sheet so you can study the scripture we'll look at. And then Catherine got in touch with us, and it ties in beautifully with this morning's message of letting our light shine into the community. How do we do that? Well, by praying, by getting involved, by volunteering with the likes of safe families. Allowing all that Jesus has given us, all that God's done for us to benefit others also. Not just covering it up with a bucket and keeping it hidden. And it's crucial in our day and age when people have so much disrespect for church and for what goes on in this building, that we reach out to them and in kindness and love and charity and whatever way we want to call it, we touch lives because Jesus touched our life. We wouldn't be here today if He hadn't touched our lives, if His light hadn't shone into our hearts. So as we look at this, I want to call this morning the faith and hope that enables us to share. To share Jesus' love, God's love for us. And these are beautiful scripture verses that speak about that, speak directly to us. And we sang there in Psalm 119, "Your word is a lamp to my feet, a light on my path." Now, surely you don't want to cover up the light. If you pass somebody on the road who is worse off than you, surely you don't want to keep the light and say, no, you're not getting anything. You're not getting any of it. We want that light to be experienced by all and everyone. So remember those words, your light is a lamp for my feet and a light on my path. We're going to look at four things this morning. They are illuminated by faith, the faith that we have in God, empowered by hope, which is the hope that God has given us, walking together because it's not an individual thing, and take up the torch. Take up the torch. The first thing then, illuminated by faith, shining beyond ourselves, as one commentator called this verse 14 of Matthew 5, shining beyond ourselves. Faith is the spark that ignites our inner light, isn't it? Once it was dark and gloomy and we felt everything. Mother Teresa often spoke about the light that was in her life, and she said it is a beacon of compassion in the depths of this place. And she was speaking about Calcutta and all the dark, gloomy areas that she helped people in. Her light wasn't a hidden lamp, but a radiant sun warming countless lives, somebody said of her. And like her, we are called to translate faith into action. Letting our good works shine brightly. See, because God is the primary source, we see right from the beginning of the Word of God this morning, if we were to study through and flick through, we would see right from the beginning, in verse 3 of Genesis 1, God begins by bringing light into existence. He set out what he wants to do. He doesn't want to live in darkness. He wants to live in light. He wants us to live in light. And he wants everybody around him. This was what God established from the beginning. The light and the darkness, it represents goodness and order and knowledge, while darkness symbolizes chaos and evil and ignorance. We only have to think of one or two things that we've mentioned in the news to apply that logic. When you think about goodness and order and knowledge, we see that the church should walk in those constraints. It should walk in an attitude of goodness towards all, towards order, towards knowledge that is found in God. And when we look at our saying in Psalm 119, your word is the knowledge that we seek as Christians. Now, if we were to think, how do we look at that in a situation? Well, I saw a story this week where a teenager had witnessed bullying in her school. The fear in her urged silence. It's what it does with all of us, isn't it? When we see something that's not quite right happening to somebody else, do we get involved or not? We've been told, just let it go by. Don't bother yourselves. You'll just make trouble for yourself. But the faith in that young girl, the faith compelled her to speak up. It was an injustice. It was wrong. It was dark. She wanted to bring light into that situation. The courage sparked a wave of support, and it turned the tide against the darkness that was happening with the bullies. Sarah's light ignited by faith changed her school in an instant. It brought light into the darkness. And that's what we see Matthew is telling us in verse 14. We are called to be light, not passive observers. And that faith should ignite us to do something, not in a condemnation kind of way, not in a judgmental way, but in a way that directs people on the right path with the right light. And it's how we apply the good works that God has given us. It might be in a small way, it might be in a large way. It might be just helping by finances. It might be just encouraging somebody with a text message or a note or even a letter or a card. Ultimately, it's to give glory to God. That's what our passage says, isn't it, in verse 16. In the same way, let your light shine before others, not in a way to feel big-headed and, whoa, look what I've done, but it's in a way that your good deeds will glorify your Father in heaven. Your good deeds. So where is the light needed? Think about it this morning. Think about your life and what is dark around you. How could you bring light into that situation? Because we're empowered by hope, aren't we? Hope has given us something to stand for. It's given us something to be enriched with. It's rooted in God's promise all the way through Bible, all the way through Scripture. There's a promise for each and every one's life. There was a promise for the early church fathers. There is a promise for the disciples. There is a promise for you and me. Even in the bleakest storm, as we've encountered this week, we've surely encountered those kind of storms in our spiritual lives. And even in the bleakest storm, hope whispers reassurance. Isaiah reminds us that God's reward, it isn't about earthly goods, but it's a reflection of His glory. I was thinking the other day about characters that have allowed that reflection. When I think about Nelson Mandela imprisoned, yet his hope was radiant and he was willing to forgive. His hope wasn't in freedom, but in a brighter future for his people. He just didn't think about him getting out. He thought about his people getting out of the slavery and the wrongdoing that they'd encountered for years. That promise is found. Surely your reward is with me. That's what the Lord Almighty declares. Surely your reward is with me, and my prize is with you, he says. He thinks of you as a precious treasure. When one of us is saved, the angels rejoice because one sinner has turned back to God. How much do you give glory to God for what He's done? When we walk in hope, we see, yes, there is a divine reward because we'll be eternally kept in His presence. But the verse here offers that our faithful actions are not forgotten, and God sees our dedication. And the promise to reward is not about material things here, it's about spiritual fulfillment. It's about that assurance that we're given. It's rooted in righteousness, and it's displayed by His splendor. What challenges us? What challenges us to look around us, to pass that hope on, to give that hope to somebody else who is probably destitute and lost and has no understanding of what God offers through salvation? Give that hope to someone else. And then we could walk together with them. Because that's the promise, isn't it? We're like a constellation of lights. We're like the sky in the night without a cloud. We're just bright, shining stars for God. As Catherine said, we're not isolated. We're not isolated, but we're a dazzling constellation together. That's my third point for us, that remember the early Christians, they were individual lights that were united by the power of the Holy Spirit, and they transformed the world. Imagine the impact if we combined our efforts. Imagine what the 33 families in the Western Isles would be doing if Safe Families UK hadn't got the initiative to come to the Western Isles and speak to Catherine's heart. Imagine what it would have been like for those 33 families if Safe Families hadn't come. Now there's a combined effort. There's a working together for one goal. That's sometimes the thing, isn't it, that we lose a little bit of the way because we've done it that way for years. And sometimes it needs a fresh initiative to come in. It needs something to come in and spark our light again, to ignite us with a way forward. Jesus is the light. John, he identifies Jesus as the true light that enlightens every man coming into the world. And in John 1:9, we see that it's His physical body that brings a spiritual light into the darkness, and it offers guidance and knowledge and salvation. Then through that, believers are called to be children of light. Ephesians 5:8 tells us that. We are to reflect the light of Christ through good works and witness. In the book of Revelations, which we're studying in the evening, when we get to Revelation 21:23, it tells us that the glory of God is the source of light for all that is created. And we'll see Him shining like the sun. So we're to walk together like stars in the world. Paul reminded us that of in Philippians 2, like stars in the world. The constellation bright and illuminating the path for others. So my call to you this morning is to take up the torch. Take up the torch and keep your light burning brightly. We are called to be cities set on a hill, beacons visible to all. Don't let our light be hidden. Share your faith through your actions. Actions that God has given us. You know, when we see people who have that light within them that's burning so bright, it can't but want to break out and illuminate others. And you very often see people just huddling round them. Huddling round these who have that brightest light. And they want to know how they have got that light. So that they can be like that. There's a story of a retired teacher who continued her passion for educating people by volunteering at a center for English. Her dedication ignited a love for learning with countless adults, with people from all walks of life, from every nation, from every tongue and tribe. And it was a beacon for people to head towards, proving that the age is no barrier to share your light. Doesn't matter what it's in, you can share how you have got that light, where you've got that light from, but most of all, you can share where that light is taking you. And it's one day taking us to be with the Lord Jesus, eternally, forever, in His Son light. So what are we to do? Well, let's go forth. That's what we're asked to do. In conclusion, I bring to you, we're not isolated lights, but we're lights that come together and shine brightly. And very often, in the nervousness of doing something like that, it's another person alongside us that helps us to be the light that shines. I remember those many years ago when myself and Gordon were going through our training, the ideas that came to us were just rampant. They were never a dull week with us. But when there was a dull moment, his encouragement helped me, and my encouragement helped him. And through it, there were as initiatives that started up that I know are still going today. But it wasn't because of who we were. We were out the other night at a do for the local community and the aged in the community. And at that time, somebody said to me, "Oh, you like to be up on the stage, you go up there." And I said, "No, I don't. I don't like to be up there. I would rather be at the back where Colin Alex's sitting. I would rather be where Alistair's sitting this morning. But you know why I'm here? Because God put a call on my life, and that call was to share His light to others. Not because I was an electrical worker for the electricity board, but because God put a spark in my heart. And that's the only way we can do it. He ignites the call. He ignites the good works. And then we take His light forward. Not my light, but His light. And that light is Jesus. He is the true light, and He's the one who speaks into lives, speaks into darkness. And this morning, you might know somebody who is in the darkest of places, but your light that has been put there by Jesus can bring them out of that darkness. Wouldn't that be a wonderful story? Wouldn't that be an amazing transformation? Isn't that what God's given us? Yes. In all of our lives, if we've trusted in the Lord Jesus, He's empowered us to do these things. And I do pray that this week you'll think about taking that torch and going forward. Perhaps it's about filling in one of those interested forms, getting some further information on how you can help Save Families UK. Perhaps it's about being a volunteer and mentoring somebody who is less fortunate than we have had in our past. Perhaps it's about just being an encouragement. I do pray that God would move in your heart this morning, as indeed He's moved in many before. Amen. Now we're going to sing in hymn number 564, "Guide me, O thou great Jehovah, pilgrim through this barren land. I am weak, but thou art mighty. Hold me with thy powerful hand." This evening, please join with us at 6 p.m. if you're able to. We're looking at the white cloaks that were in Revelation 7. We'll say the benediction to finish. Now, may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forevermore. Amen.